These are all stories of the co-op as it is today. But the co-op is more than an idea. It's more than you or me. This is the story of a house. Let me regale you with a tale.
This house, the Cyclopsilon House, was built way back in 1908. It was funded primarily by its two sugar daddies, George H. Warren and Horace Lowdy, and the chapter alumni of Cyclopsilon, University of Minnesota, U chapter. Cyclopsilon itself was founded in Union College in 1833.
It's the fifth oldest fraternity in the United States.
It was founded on poetry. A group of young men would gather once a week to recite poetry and essays, eventually forming the fraternity.
The original lot was 165 feet by 66 feet, but 12 feet of the original 165 was sold to make space for the alley, and 16 and a half feet of the original 66 was sold to make room for Delta Tau Delta's chapter house, our neighbors.
We still don't know for sure exactly when the extension was built, but we theorize that it was part of the original construction. It wasn't built by a co-op or after the fact, and it was originally intended, we think, to house a house father, if you will.
The house father would have been someone that took care of the people that lived in the fraternity at the time. Cyclopsilon would have probably been an alumni of the fraternity. The house father would have had his own bathroom, own living room, own bedroom. It would have been a nice gig. We learned from one of our neighbors, neighbor Dan, that his fraternity had an area of the house similar to this. So we think the theory holds a lot of water.
Hello there. Just wanted you to know that this house was originally gray stucco, and it had X-shaped muttons over the windows. It was designed by the prominent architectural firm Frederick G. Keyes and Cyrenus Colburn of the firm Keyes and Colburn. They built such prominent Minneapolis landmarks as City Hall, the Masonic Temple, the Charles M. Harrington House, the Loring Theater, and the courthouse. But what's interesting is they built our house after they built City Hall.
The house is the second oldest remaining frat house on Fraternity Row, the fourth constructed, and is a contributing property in the Fraternity Row Historic District by the Minneapolis Heritage and Preservation Society. It exemplifies the scale and style of the pre-World War period. Wow, what a changing world this house has seen.
Co-op was founded in 1939, but officially in 1940 by the Midland Cooperatives Incorporated, a large dairy cooperative, who was directly responsible for buying the house and starting the students' co-op.
Cyclopsilon had resided in the house until they officially moved to Chi Phi House. Except for a stint during World War I, where the house was turned over to the university to become an SATC, Student Army Training Corps, barracks, until it was recovered by Cyclopsilon in 1919.
The co-op originally had 40 members, all male.
Not anymore!
It had a single house leader, and was a boarding house for 100 extra individuals who would come to the co-op for meals. Someone would stand at the front door and collect money from boarders as they entered. People were not voted to live in the house, but would just show up, show interest, and then get accepted in. There was a business meeting once a week, and co-opers received direct support from business training and business training from business staff at Midland.
There were chores similar to those of today, cleaning, dishes, etc. Originally, the top floor had no rooms, just a wide open space filled with bunk beds and cots for residents. The second floor was partitioned into rooms which were used as study rooms.
When they threw parties for homecoming and such, ladies weren't allowed past the first floor.
There was no stereo, so a piano player would pump on the jams. And in the extension, that's where the house mother lived. She would do motherly things for the men in the house.
There was also a hired cook. Sadly, she had kidney problems.
According to this report by former co-oper Don Ellen, in 1978, two co-opers plotted to acquire the co-op property and sell it for their own profit. John Sukup, manager, and Pete Gensler, president, quietly influenced the membership of the board of directors and gained their individual trust over the next year and a half. In 1980, two of the more supposedly mature and experienced co-opers, Dave Schneider and Doug Hooper, were out of the country for a couple of weeks, and John and Pete made their move. They convinced the board that the title of the property was at risk from procedural error, and the Mormons were trying to acquire their property. The only way to protect the house was to transfer it to John and Pete's house painting company, G&S Development, until the title issue could be sorted out. The only reason that the board fell for such a scam was apparently because of the close friendship they thought they had with John and Pete. When Dave and Doug returned, they quickly realized what had happened, but since they still had the bank assets, they were still a corporation.
A meeting was held, and John and Pete were fired, and attorneys were hired to file a lawsuit against G&S. John and Pete hoped to drag the proceedings out long enough so that they could defeat the effort to regain control of the co-op. At first, they planned to stay at the house. However, certain individuals took it upon themselves to carry out a program of harassment that included sleep deprivation, veiled threats, and harassment. The resolution of the residents, based on their love of the co-op and their outrage over the betrayal, eventually led them through to success, as John and Pete agreed to sign the title back over to Students Cooperative Incorporated. At this time, the co-op experienced a renaissance in efforts to repair and maintain the building and provide food service and work systems that have made and continue to make the co-op a great place to live.
In the 90s, not much was changed with the physical aspect of the house. Except the Asian boiler was replaced with our current steam system.
In the 2000s, work had to be done. Projects were headed by Steve Bice, the maintenance manager then, and huge repairs were made, including rerouting the storm drains outside of the house, building new retaining walls, which lies technically outside of our property line. And they also replaced the roof.
However, the roof, which cost $23,000, was misinstalled by B&K Roofing. So through our lawyer, Steve Kelly, or possibly delinquent lawyer, Steve Martin, we sued the contractors for misinstalling the roof and for not purchasing a warranty from the manufacturer. By court order, the company owes the co-op a lot of money, even tens of thousands of dollars. But the company disbanded, and as far as we know, the money has not been received yet.
Jump forward to the 2010s, yet another exciting era.
With the rebirth of co-op retreats,
restructuring of chores,
and manager positions,
and the reinstating of the UMN co-op student group,
taking on big projects like the new window installations,
and the building up of a
strong alumni support network,
reworking policies,
applying for nonprofit status,
and the goal of building a new co-op in the horizon.
The future is bright as the co-op continues to do its thing.